The program was designed for inmates who have received disciplinary reports and for inmates who have been validated as members of the STG group, security threat group. This program was implemented in August of 2013 at 7 of the closed security prisons. The purpose of creation is management and stratification-oriented pathways for offenders to successfully transition from administrative segregation to lower security levels. Also, to provide greater management and implementation programs for long-term administrative segregation offenders. These words sound like they're practicing their ethics of correction and rehabilitation. However, as an eyewitness slash victim, these words disguise their true intentions to cause pernicious mental damage to their rebellious prisoners. There are three programs with three phases to each level. Tier 1 is a 30-day program with privileges to have all your property and receive commissary without any restriction. Tier 2 is a 6-month program that has a phase review every 90 days. Their privileges are limited at first to the inmate's only possession is what the state issues out. No pictures, store goods, unless it's writing material and their choice of hygiene, and no non-legal mail. Tier 3 is a program I believe to be no less than 270 days before being dropped down to Tier 2. The catch to these programs are the ways they excuse their actions of placing inmates on the tier program unjustly, such as the severity of past disciplinary reports and how many you have received in a certain time limit, which you have already been disciplinary for, pending investigation, weapon disciplinary infractions, and many more so-called infractions to their rules and regulations. At Georgia State Prison, the tier occupants are being held in the condemned part of the prison.
We will be finishing off where we left off. Mr. Ladarius Coleman, may you please finish off where you started?
Like I said before, the flush buttons for their toilet have been placed outside the doors along with the light switch, forcing the offenders who live in the designed one-man cell to inhale toxins and fumes of defecation from their roommates. The meal portions are scant and always under the required 2,800 calorie quota. The housing quarters are unsanitized with dust from past construction work for remodeling reasons, food, feces, and rodent turds. The entire prison is infested with an uncontrollable rodent and insect problem, especially where the tier program is being used. They treat the prisoner with the belly of the beast cruelly and use starvation as his main tactic of control. Yes, I will admit the violence rate has lessened to a certain extent, but the antagonizing behavior by the police and psychological torment has intensified. The fiduciary for our prison walked in G2 dormitory where the tier program is being held, doing his weekly rounds. I was just so happened to be sneaking food to my fellow comrade when he entered the building. With no way to escape, I hid in the holding pens in the back of the dorm, hoping he would walk on through. As he approached the middle of the dorm, he made the following statement. For those of you who keep complaining about your due process rights, I'ma let you know now. I don't care about if you did or did not have a DR. I don't care about your constitutional rights neither. If you have potential, I will put you on my tier program. It's never personal, it's just business. Through his spiteful words and arrogant authority, he revealed his way of teachings and motives behind his role in their corrupt structure of capitalism and institutional genocide. Utilizing your rights against their forces of repression makes you that potential. The one potential to win a lawsuit. The one potential to get trades back into the Georgia penal system. The potential to revolutionize the parole board for the betterment. Freeing our sons, fathers, uncles, friends, husbands, sisters, aunties, wives, and protectors of our communities back in society. The potential to get justice behind these minions of oppressive order injustice. Two wrongs will never make a right. So by me going about it the right way, that makes me a potential to be the next victim placed in the torture chamber, also known as the tier program. I leave you with encouragement and loyalty to our struggle. Please listen to the unheard cries and come investigate these issues in this prison, because this is not justice, it's just torture.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That was a beautiful, amazing speech I know that everyone have just heard this. I would like for everyone to please take heed to everything that was said, and we will be informing y'all and keep y'all in tune and updating on other things that's going on inside the penal system and the courts. This is just the beginning, but it's so.
Oh yeah, Black Sun in the hizzle off a shizzle dizzle. Can I get somebody back there to let Mike know that we are not live? Let Mike know. We got an interesting show here today, but first I want to say the views and opinions and that of the arena does not reflect that of the Comcast, its staff, or associates. And the views of Black Sun does not reflect that of the arena. If somebody back there can go tell Mike, okay, we're live. No, we're live. Okay. We got an interesting show here today. Before, I just want to introduce my panel to my right. Introduce yourself, bro.
My name is Del McLean, also known as Earthworm, and I've been corresponding with some prisoners who are hunger striking in protest of the brutal conditions in the Georgia State Prison in Reedsville.
Okay. To her right.
I am Gideon Ben Yasharal, a prisoner in the cell block called America, sitting on death row, the servant of Yah.
You are not in no goddamn prison, then, Gideon. You're on goddamn Comcast. Go ahead, gang. I'm sorry.
What's good, man? Brother Yanga, good to be here again, always, you know. I missed last weekend, I believe it was. Last Sunday I missed.
Yes. You were here in spirit.
Always.
We're going to set up a show. We're going to do a debate show because, you know, Gideon and Vince, our researcher, have the nerve to challenge me on the period of Stalin and Hitler.
What?
Have the nerve.
That's what happens.
That's what happens, man.
The researchers, you know, that's how it is. He's a research man.
Well, I'm about to beat him down. Let's get started. All right. Earthworm, we just heard recording of the prisoners. Sound like they had some harsh conditions. I'm assuming this is a private prison?
No, it's a Georgia State prison.
Whoa,
so, but okay. You'll see harsh conditions in both.
Right.
So the main demand of the prisoners is to end this tier program that you heard, that was Ladarius Kohlberg, one of the prisoners talking about, where they have these three increasingly severe levels of restriction that the prisoners are on. So you'll see in tier two, all your personal possessions are taken away. You're not allowed to have family photos or newspapers, only things that are issued by the prison. And you see two people housed in a one-man cell with the light switch and the flush button for the toilet outside of the cell, so they're not able to flush their own toilet.
Whoa.
They have to wait for a guard to come around, and a guard's supposed to come around at a certain period of time, but oftentimes that doesn't happen, so they'll be sitting there for hours breathing in these smells, and they're supposed to be eating in the at the same time.
Some people would argue they're prisoners. I mean, what rights, you know, they gave up their personal freedom when they were convicted of a crime, when they chose to do whatever they did to do, that it shouldn't be comfortable. That prison is a deterrent for, you know, it's not a holiday hotel.
So in that case, the question is, where does it end? Where do we stop saying, okay, they're prisoners, we can treat them however we want? Is it okay for the guards to issue beatings whenever they want to? Because that's happening. In non-resistant or non-violent prisoners, is that okay? Is it okay that there have been multiple suicides and that's not being addressed?
Right.
You know, they're supposed to get 2,800 calories a day, but I'm being told by these prisoners that they're getting half portions. So, and in fact, Kelvin J. Stevenson, one of the prisoners on hunger strike, says that if you look around, you'll see that every prisoner in there is malnourished.
Wow.
And he believes that that's part of a deliberate program to control the prisoners and keep them more docile because they're less able to resist. So we really have to look at what is a human right, what human
that's
rights
right.
are prisoners entitled to, you know, and where does this idea of, well, they're not entitled to too much comfort turn into these are human rights that everybody's entitled to.
Interesting. Well, let's define human rights. I mean, because, well, I'm sure there's some type of health violation for the, you know, them to guards, the COs go around and push and flush the toilet. I mean, that has to be violation of some type of.
But you know, I mean, we got to play devil's advocate. I guess I'm the one to play devil's advocate. I think that a lot of the argument would be that it gives them the ability to control the, for them to get rid of contraband. See, if you don't have access to flush your toilet, you don't have access to get rid of the contraband. And we know that a lot in the prisons, there's a lot of contraband, cell phones, drugs, a lot of things. So I think that, and then my question was, are these maximum security prisons?
I'm not sure what level of security the prisons are, but the tier program is a special unit within a given prison.
Okay. And so I know a lot of their argument would be for officer and staff safety. What would be the response to that, or but I really wish your friend could have made it. You know what I'm saying? So we could have a talk. And like I said, you know, we had to play devil's advocate to get here. My heart goes out to our brothers and sisters, to our comrades locked behind enemy lines, locked in there. You know, we stand with solidarity to you. But just to get to the meat of the show. But what would some of the responses be to those that, as far as staff safety, for them to be able to control how the if the inmates will be able to get rid of the contraband? This is why the was access to flushing the commodes are outside of the cells and things of that nature.
I think you'd have to look at each thing and actually analyze, does this make sense? Okay, does it make sense that them not being able to flush their own toilets is actually going to keep them from being able to flush contraband? So do the guards check in the toilets before they flush them? I assume not. They're doing it from outside the cells, right? So would that really prevent any kind of contraband from being caught? I doubt it. And what about things like the infestation with the insects and the mice that we heard Ladarius talking about? Does that serve a purpose? Or even if there is a purpose, if, as Calvin says, they're deliberately malnourishing the prisoners in order to keep them more docile, is that a purpose that we want to allow them to be able to do?
Yeah, because what would be, you know, like, I mean, I can understand the contraband argument, but the calories a day, you reducing down the rations, what can be the logical argument for?
Right. Well, I guess you would have to have a nutritionist to come in and to say, who overchecks these? Like, you know, who are the persons that come? Is there a prison inspection team?
Right.
Is it federal? Is it state sponsored? Who are the people that comes in and says, okay, this prison is running up to code or running up to standard, that this isn't a violation of human rights or this isn't cruel and inhumane punishment?
And that speaks to a really important issue, which is, where's the transparency here? All these things are going on behind closed doors. They're limiting these prisoners' ability to reach out to family, to have family visits. And they're, you know, they even have, prisoners have even said that they suspect they're going through their mail and keeping mail out.
Right.
So they're limiting the ability to get the word out about what's going on. So where is the oversight?
Yeah.
You know, where, and that's been one of the demands from Kelvin, one of the men on hunger strike, is he wants a Department of Justice official to come and investigate this prison and talk to the prisoners, including him, so that they can find out if regulations are being followed.
Right, well, so there's no oversight committee? I mean, is there one? Who do they go to?
Theoretically, there should be, right? I mean, I assume that theoretically, if you talk to the warden of the prison, he would say that everything's in line, everything's been checked out. But in practice, when you look at what's really going on, clearly something is slipping through the cracks.
Yeah,
absolutely. Especially when we got, you know, roaches running around. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's... Well,
they're going to tell you is the 14th Amendment. What does the 14th Amendment say? You over there quiet, Gideon.
I know
you
got some.
14th Amendment says that what? Slavery is abolished except for what?
Prisoners.
Yeah, but even slaves get fed, though, Yanga.
No, we ain't giving them half portions, hell.
Oh, man. I mean, this
you might get a biscuit, you ain't get no gravy.
I mean, it sounds like Gitmo.
Exactly. Hey, but, you know, that's what a gray area is, you know, with like, Earthworm is saying that if there's no oversight committee, if there's no investigation committee, what defies human
it's
rights?
Not effective.
Right. Or it's
not
exists, effective.
But it's not
and going to the warden is like the fox guarding the hen house.
Right. That's right.
You know, you can go to the warden. His job is, of course, he's going to tell you, well, my prison's, you know, tip top and it's run according to regulations. What are the regulations? What
First
are the,
of all,
you know?
anytime, this is why I wanted to get into whole environmental science. The warden, the COs, none of them are qualified in health. Mm-hmm. You know, they're just qualified to watch prisoners, watch contrabands, and put slap the cuffs on you and throw you in a hole. But they are not qualified to know what is deemed as healthy and unhealthy. So that should be an independent,
body.
Yeah.
And Kelvin writes, quote, cells are filthy and infested with insects and mice. Staph and scabies are constantly present.
Oh, yeah.
And medical staff care less whether we live or die.
Mm-hmm.
So here's the problem. You know, maybe these medical staff exist, but what's enforcing them to do their job well?
I think they're going to do the bare minimum. You know, I think they're going to do the bare minimum. I mean, you really have to have, like you said, an independent body, independent committee to go in there and look. Because I did my little time, I was younger back then, did my little time, and I saw it going from worse to bad to worse, and even
right.
below that. Because, you know, back in the day when I did my time, at least you could have libraries.
Right.
And you could have to wait. And I think it was Zell Miller, who was the governor at that time. He said, the only thing we're doing is making the criminals smarter and stronger. So he took the library and took all the program. You know, when I was in there, you could get a trade. Not that it did any good when you came home, because soon they seen Department of Corrections on it. They weren't going to hire you. But at least you could get a trade, you know. Now they have taken out the trade schools and the colleges and stuff like that. But there were a lot of people who were saying that, you know, why should their tax dollars go to this? Why should these people are being penalized for crimes that they committed? Why should they be able to go here and have all of these amenities and things of that nature?
And notice how you say there were people complaining.
Yeah.
Nobody to counter-argue that complaint, Gideon.
Yeah.
Because you got to register to vote now, don't you, there?
Well, No.
You made the vote, God dang. Go ahead, Gideon. I'm sorry.
Well, the issue has to do, I've been inside the prison industrial complex, specifically the one over here on Constitution. And they're normally self-contained cities, mm-hmm. where they have their own gardens, they have their own facilities. They're a self-contained entity. But what you have are the brutal masochists and sadists that are inside these prison walls. And the prisoners themselves have become masochists mm-hmm. and sadists
mm-hmm.
who perpetrate filth and crime and disease one upon another. Because it's very easy to keep your cell clean. But if you have this killer dog in the same cell with you, that his mind is filled with filth, he's a filthy person, then he perpetuates filth. So the issue of the incarceration, we can look at Malcolm X, for example. Malcolm X went in, and like you said, during that time, they were allowed to read and so forth, and I think they still are able to read.
Getting it, but how do you explain, okay, the half rations? Like, how would you, I hear your argument about the keeping clean and mm-hmm. rats and roaches, but the half portions. See, I'm going to keep coming back to this half portions, man.
Again, sadist and masochist. You have individuals who, as you, in America, human rights are just obliterated. They don't care. They look at us as less than human.
So
in that environment, then it perpetuates the same ideology of lack of humanity, and it's even amplified because at the end of the day, these individuals have perpetrated. They're down on themselves. Mm-hmm. They because they're in an incarcerated environment. They're depressed. That causes, and then you have other demented individuals in there. So you've got a concentration of disease, malnutrition, and self-hatred. I mean, what do you expect you're going to get out
right.
of that?
My question, there again, I'm playing devil's advocate, is if that was brought before, some they would say, how is he qualified to say that they're malnutritioned? Because a lot of times, if you're just going off of calorie counts, a lot of it may not be fulfilling. You may not get full portions to where you're full, but is he sure that the people are really malnutrition? And how would he, is he qualified to make that assessment? He or she qualified to make that assessment?
No, so, I mean,
well,
that's
here's
a good point.
Where you need the oversight from an actual professional body, and we, the population, need to make sure that that's actually happening. Because right now we are just going on the word of a prisoner, and it's easy enough for the prison officials to just say, oh, he doesn't know what he's talking about, or he's lying or something.
Well, neither one of them are qualified, the prisoner or the guard.
Or the guard.
Yeah, neither one of them are qualified.
So that's where we need to actually put pressure so that the prisoners can feel that they haven't been forgotten about, because you're talking about this sense of hopelessness, this sense of depression. And you can really hear that from some of the letters of the people that have been involved in the hunger strike. Like this one is from Ladarius, who we heard the recording from. But he says, no one wants their property destroyed, then thrown in the hole for an unknown reason. No one feels that there's a need to stand for the many hopeless strugglers. Honestly, sometimes I question my limits of drive. Why am I fighting for a people who doesn't see the empowerment behind the revolution? So, and this guy is incredibly committed and incredibly fearless. You know, he's put himself in complete danger of being punished, of being put on this tier program, which right now he's in population. So this is a guy who in no way is cowardly. He's incredibly brave, but you can feel that hopelessness.
Well, let me just say this as well, because see, what you have in the history of America is you have Buchenwald, you have Auschwitz. What they have is a historical perspective of how people can be degenerated and just made to waste away, and then ultimately put in death camps and crematoriums. So when they see our people go into these facilities and we come out looking good, still strong, they're like, man, these people, we can't be coddling these individuals, because we still come out beautiful, as we saw.
Looking better than
when we went in, eating all this poisoned food out here.
See it, trying to get waves in
the air. Everything. You know what I'm talking about? A partner of mine, Calvin Johnson, we graduated from high school Southwest. He went in wrongfully accused of a rape. That brother went in. He looked better when he was in. He got built up and everything.
What year was that, Gideon?
This was like, I would say around 80.
1800s?
80, no, 80, 83, 84.
Okay, that's ancient
history.
Because
we got out of high school 75.
Okay, Gideon, that's ancient history.
We're
in the new age now.
I'm telling you,
goddamn ISIS.
Therein lies the very point that you're making, because Gitmo really reflects the mentality, the sadomasochistic mentality of the jailers, and how even in what's supposed to be a top priority prison like Gitmo, they went in and used specific torture techniques to break the prisoners. So when they see our people are able to adapt and adjust to anything, and in prison, we can flourish in prison, even there. But what they don't want you to just be in prison. If they see you still looking good and you got a positive spirit, they want to break you. And therein lies the sickness that's not only in the prison industrial complex, it's in America. They want to break us.
Well, it sounds like from the report that there needs to be an independent, like I said, because, again, taking the prisoner's word, taking the official's word, neither one of them are qualified. So there has to be, you know, and I guess their medical staff, I mean.
Do their job, and we, the population, need to make sure that that's really happening in an effective way.
I agree with that. And I'm going to say, and I apply, what's the brother's name, Darius?
Ladarius.
And we don't say too much, we don't want to get a brother in too much hot water. But I apply Ladarius. And one of the things that he said, I think, was a key point when he was saying that, you know, sometimes he feels like, what's the point with a lot of, anytime, I mean, a lot of these inmates really, is making the case hard, because, you know, and I got partners that call home, they got cell phones in there, these dudes got Facebook posts, you know what
I'm
saying?
Blog talk shows.
Man, they do blog talk
shows. Man, they running their drug industry from in prison.
It is rough to make a, you know, and this is what gives the officers a lot of them carte blanche to start to really squeeze down on these rules and regulations. They're saying that their life is in threat. People are putting, one of the things I heard, are people are putting hits on them from the outside, you know, getting these gang members, you know.
They are so Hollywood.
Real.
Yeah,
it's real.
I mean, that's, if you.
How
if
many
you
cases have you known prisoners being hit by a prison?
Not hit inside the prison. They're saying with access to the outside world.
Yeah, the hit, you know, is coming hit from prison.
From prison. It's like, yo, this is officer in here, blue.
Right.
You know, take care of business, because they have access to the outside world. So a lot of, real or imaginary. I'm not saying, you know, they're saying that you have, anytime you give, it's just like 9/11. Conspiracy or not, right. Whatever. The after effect of it. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
The lockdown. They use that fear.
Exactly. They use that fear to push their agenda.
But now you have to remember Rice Street, right here in the city of Atlanta. Mm-hmm. Rice Street Jail, they went in there, they had not just marijuana joints, mm-hmm. they had pounds of marijuana. They had cocaine. Pounds of marijuana, home.
Wait a minute.
Cocaine.
Is this true, Yanga?
Cell phone. Everything. I'm talking about, they had it on the news.
Wait.
Well, you got the police.
Officers.
The corruption, it starts with the people who are watching them. Mm-hmm. Because they get money. These people have money on their books.
Again, independent oversight.
Well, that's just like having, you know, we had the person that came here about the, what they call it, the people's...
Citizens Review Board.
Yeah.
If the Citizen Review Board doesn't have any teeth, it's just a bunch of people talking about what's going on and it's still going down because at the end of the day, they don't have the power to enforce the information that they're equipped with. You just sending it back to the same corrupt police force and they flush it down the toilet with the rest of the stuff.
Right, but that's why it comes back to us, right? Yeah. We can't just put it on the government and be like, all right, government, go ahead and handle that.
Yeah.
Of course they're not going to do that. Power never concedes anything without a demand, right? And we have to be the demand. We're the civilians. We have to be putting that pressure to force them to do the right thing because they're not going to do the right thing just out of the goodness of their heart.
Well, see, when you have a political platform that's based off we need to control these indigent, well, not necessarily indigent, that has to do with economics, but these mad dog killers, We don't need to be soft on crime. That is the mantra for the political proponents to create this concept of fear from the populace to say we're protecting you from these mad dog killers from Frankenstein that we created.
And that's what they're trying to do is to push the discussion over to this to turn, okay, all these criminals, they're so terrifying, we need to take away their human rights because somehow that's going to protect us. And by letting them take control of the conversation and by debating that conversation over in their far right of the field, we're forgetting about, okay, what about the human rights? What kind of a society do we really want to see here?
That's right.
But does that fall under civil? Now does the prison, that's why we
say
the government, does it fall under civil and does it have to be elevated to human rights violations? Or is this just a civil thing, saying that every state or every nation has a right, or particularly states, because I realize that even from state to state, the rules and regulations inside the penal system varies. So is every state responsible for their own rules and regulations? And how would you elevate it to a human rights issue?
Good question.
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because I want to just read quickly, if I can, the list of demands that they drew up.
Yeah. Oh, yes, please.
Absolutely.
And to me, these are very basic human rights. He says, A, no prisoners should be held in a special management unit for longer than 30 days. Rehouse all prisoners currently in the TIER programs in the Department of the Correction. B, interaction with other prisoners every day. C, time spent outdoors with space and basic equipment for exercise every day. Mm-hmm. D, healthy food items with full food portion sizes and clean water every day. Mm-hmm. E, proper clothing, footwear, and climate temperature control. Mm-hmm. F, a complete end to the use of threat and violence by staff against prisoners who have not made any physical threat to staff. Mm-hmm. G, access to phone calls and contact visits with family at least once a week. Mm-hmm. H, timely and proper health care. Mm-hmm. I, access to engage in productive activities, including correspondence courses and vocational and remedial education courses. J, a meaningful way to grieve any abuses or denial of the stated basic rights. K, weekly access to the satellite law library for opportunity to adequately litigate. And then his second portion is more just about no group punishment. And he lists different ways in which group punishment is used. For example, no punishment for what individuals of the same race/nation/organizational affiliation do unless you as an individual were involved in violating a rule or law, i.e. no group punishment. Mm. So some of those are undeniably
basic
human rights. Like, mm-hmm. they talk about being in cells that are boiling hot or freezing cold, right. depending on the summer or the winter. And some of them, you might say, okay, well, does that really count as a human right to have access to visit your family once right. a week? Right. But what kind of a environment do we want to create? And that another issue brought up by
some people are very liberal. They would say that you're very liberal, you're very self-hearted. Like the exercise equipment, the visiting families, all those human rights.
So, and do we need to stop at human rights? Do we want to say, let's deprive the prisoners of everything that's not absolutely a basic human right? Because one of the things that Calvin has brought up is these guys are, most of them, eventually going to get released back into the society.
Exactly.
And if you're teaching them nothing but hate and fear and deprivation, exactly. what impact is that going to have on the society?
Well, we see what impact. Exactly. What do we got out here? Killers, robbers, rapists, hit men and women,
yeah.
Sadomasochists. Mm-hmm. What you're saying is really what the prison industrial complex is working exactly the way they want it.
To work, right?
They really want chaos, pandemonium. They want these rampant killers. That's what. So the politicians go out there and say, mm-hmm. this is why we need more money. We need more money for the prisons. We need more prisons than we need educational facilities. Mm-hmm. We need to pay more money for the prison mm-hmm. industrial complex than we need to do for education. Now we know there's a pipeline from the school system to the prison system.
Hold on, let's just keep it real. They're doing all this because they refuse to work, huh?
So you're saying that?
The prisoners.
What do you mean?
Anytime this something that this magnitude goes down is because the prisoners have organized to stop working. That's usually what this is. That's what it's. I'm listening to all this, taking this all in. When an individual knucklehead does something, they just put that person in the hole. But when they organize as a group, then they start adding stuff like this. That means they don't refuse to work.
I think there might be something to be said that this is partially retaliation
yeah.
for the strike in 2010, which was a big deal.
Yes.
Because Kelvin, who I keep mentioning, was a part of the hunger strike in 2010,
right.
and he was subsequently beaten with a claw hammer at the end of 2010 by guards. And then they, 4 days later, moved him to the SMU unit, the special management unit, which is now considered the third tier of the tier program. So they beat him up, they move him into this very restrictive isolation unit, and now he's still on the tier two. He's off of tier three, but he's still on the tier two, which is this prolonged solitary confinement. And he argues that this is all in retaliation for his
Absolutely.
Participation in the hunger strike. And he participated in the 2012 or was involved with the 2012 hunger strike as well. And for filing grievances and filing lawsuits for the brutality.
You know,
and what do they say? Now they don't want to educate them. We want to take the books out because now they're forming actual intelligent lawsuits against us. So let's take the books out. You also have to understand that when you talk about them working, there is a resentment for, first of all, many of our brethren are being incarcerated wrongfully.
Mm-hmm.
They know that. Then, not on top of that, you're making them work for the same corrupt system while you inside wrongfully to make products that at a cheaper, at a slave labor concept.
But,
go
you
ahead.
Know, a lot of prisoners have realized, you know, when they're out there, you know, like the whole city of Columbus, their whole trash and everything, every time they have football games, cleaned up by prisoners. You
right.
forget about getting private contracts or contract to work out there.
Exactly.
It ain't gonna happen.
Right.
The trash, the sanitation is all ran by the prisoners.
Right.
But the prisoners got smart. They're like, man, we're out here doing all this labor, but then y'all taxing us for the phones
right.
and the commissary.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying?
Overtaxing.
Like, right. So we wait. So that's how originally a lot of this disputed was coming. It's just like the McDonald's workers in New York, the $15 an hour.
Exactly.
This parallel was happening because originally the prisoner wanted more money
right.
for their labor.
Right.
I mean, when I say clean up whole football stadiums, they
yes.
cleaning it down.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? Taking out the trash. So they're doing labor that a normal person like me and yourself.
They're prisoners.
And then this, I think, is really the crux of the fight that we're facing here is because if we allow the right or the people that you're sort of talking about to isolate them, oh, they're just the prisoners, they're just the underclass, then that makes it really easy for them to come after the next
generation.
Yeah. So if the working class says, well, we want higher wages,
that's right.
All we have to do is get prisoners to come and do it. Well, you don't have a job anymore.
Exactly.
So as long as we're divided, it's very easy to conquer us, which I think is why we need to show solidarity with
the prisoners. Well, what Yanga is saying is really what they were, the elites were saying. They just niggas.
Yeah.
They niggas. They just put them to work. You know?
And it's fine as long as y'all don't say it. See, that's the point she's making. As long as you – if I say the niggas don't get paid and I'm goddamn a CEO, it doesn't matter as long as the people – you're not,
go along
right now,
with
right,
it.
Right, because right now,
exactly,
they're fighting for the $15 an hour.
Right.
Nationwide, McDonald's.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? So they're fighting. So what we have to see is that when we discard the prisoners, we discard ourselves.
Ourselves, exactly.
Because, like I said,
exactly,
the whole city of Columbus is all prison. Ran.
Yes, yes.
I think it's a thin line, man. I think it's a thin line. I think that we have to be, you know.
We're talking like economics
I'm all,
here.
I'm all for human rights. You know, I am all for human rights. At the same time, though, I'm not going to pretend that every Negro behind bars
is all good.
Is all good.
No.
What's wrong for being incarcerated?
No.
I believe we are political prisoners because our socioeconomic conditions that have been created. So I do believe that we're given certain, put in a certain position where we make bad choices because we're only given those choices to make due to social economic conditions that have been created by a capitalist system. So I do believe that we're all political prisoners, but I'm not going to sit there, you know, you got rapists, you got robbers, you got some real criminals in there.
True.
But if you look at the numbers, about 5%, if my memory serves, of the prison population is violent offenders.
Yeah.
Something like 60%. Okay. Is just drug offenses.
Drug, that's right.
That's it.
That's it. Drug war.
Exactly.
And then when you look at the enforcement, as Michelle Alexander points out in the new Jim Crow, drug use among whites and drug dealing among whites is at least as high
as
the black population.
Right.
You have this vastly over numbered black population.
Exactly.
So it's the unfair policing.
Exactly.
It's the unfair courts.
Exactly.
You know, the unfair, what happens to you when you get out.
Yep.
And all of this is serving to create this massive system that is actually turning into a new form of social control.
Wait a minute, Earthworm. They're not going to let you in the club. You crazy.
Hold on. Let me get this way. 770-559-2999. Y'all put that number up and call in. Put that number
exactly.
up.
Exactly.
All right.
The issue is what she's saying is so correct. I mean, Yang is making some valid points. And, of course, this is what the politicians, a wealthy elite, use to help. We need protection from them.
Right.
But the them that they're talking about, see, it's almost as if we don't look at the issue of being corrected, of being forgiven, that once a criminal, always a criminal. And what does that mean then? Don't we all make mistakes?
Yeah.
And when we look at, if you look at the congressmen, the senators, and you go into their background and what they are doing, and what has been done by the military industrial complex and the wanton killing and droning of people all across, I mean, they need to be locked up. But what they've done is targeted us. They targeted us from elementary school. They began.
Gideon, you know how to start that process?
Go ahead. Talk to us.
You got to get involved, Gideon. You got to get involved.
I ain't going to vote for the killer.
Exactly.
I agree with, you know me, you know my philosophy, my socialist leanings anyway. I believe that production, and also the production should be for means of using. That should all be controlled by the people and distributed equally for the people. That's my whole economic philosophy. That's what I believe. That's what I stand on. But we have to understand, like you were saying, the whole criminalization process with the prison industrial complex, prisons are big money.
Yes.
Right.
Prisons are big money. And I think that we should address the rights of human rights.
Yes.
But that we have to be realistic. And one of the things is petition for a independent, or try to look into getting some independent people to go in to review the prison. What are the rules and regulations of the prison?
That's right.
What is a violation of human rights? What is too much? What is too far? What is adequate penalization
right.
for crimes that are committed? I mean, the whole, it is a very big issue.
Well, you saw the difference in the sentencing with cocaine, powder cocaine versus crack.
Yeah.
Your old president. But then let me just say this, because we know in America, we make up 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the prison population. This country has more prisoners than the whole world has ever even conceived of. So you got America is, in fact, a penal colony.
Yeah.
And they profit off of this, but they use targeting their selective prosecution to put our people in jail and then turn around and have people like you, Black Son, vote for it.
Well, let me say this real quick. Let me say this real quick. Number one, I'm gonna address that in a minute there again. Going back to Yanga, when you talked about prisoners, when I'm looking at this, they're being punished as a group. Now, I agree with you. There's some knuckleheads in there, you know what I'm saying? And the prisons will punish them individually. But when you start punishing a group, that means that group is organizing. You know what I'm saying? Because I don't care what crime they done committed, whether it be drug offenses or whatever, a lot of times them brothers ain't gonna back no knucklehead. You know what I'm saying? If there's a D-boy in there and he acting off the chain.
Organizing for what, though?
Better wages.
I think that's the question. Organizing for what? If we go and ask, and again, you know.
Some human rights.
Playing the devil's advocate. The devil's advocate. If we go in there and look at what is organizing? Are the gangs organizing? Is it has the violence increased? You have to know what your opponents are going to come at you with. Why are these programs being created? You know what I'm saying? Are they for the safety of the population? Because we already know that the staff is outnumbered. The prisoners outnumber the staff, what, like 6-1?
Sure.
So then starve them?
But are create the tier program allegedly to house prisoners who are a threat to the safe and secure management of the unit. But then when you look at actually who's being placed in there, Calvin says that it's just people who are a part of a certain religious group. They have certain political views.
Well, in that case, lock the Muslims and Hebrew Israelites up. God dang it. Throw away the goddamn human rights. Go ahead. We ain't gonna have ISIS up in the goddamn prisons. I'm going.
Let me just quote Kelvin. He says, any prisoner who is a part of an organization with any form of political or religious or cultural background is then arbitrarily validated as a gang member. And this is used to justify his placement in the program.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And also the prisoners are saying that they're placed in the program as a punishment, which that's not supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to get put in the program if you take a leadership in a riot, or you're smuggling guns, or you're, you did massive amounts of property damage, these things, and it's listed what the criteria are.
Yeah.
So it's not supposed to be if you speak out against the program or if you complain about being in the program, but it's understood that that is what's going to happen. And we heard Ladarius in the recording talk about how that happens. That if you complain, you get put on the program longer.
Really? I can play devil's advocate now.
Yeah.
You mean we can torture these Hebrew Israelites, Muslims? I love it.
That's the problem, because they do label, they do have, I mean, if you pull any political. The Panther Party is labeled a gang. The 5% Nation of Islam is labeled a gang. The Nation of Islam is labeled a gang.
Mm-hmm.
Some, I think they recognize Christianity and some Orthodox Islam as long as it goes through state and they have their state chaplains come in. But anything that's not a major, like what they call one of the major threes, Judaism, Christendom, Islam, the Orthodox type, these deviations, like you and I, they probably lock you and I down.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let me say that because, see, again, I speak to the federal penitentiary on the Constitution.
Well, doesn't your Bible say fast anyway?
Yes, it
you
does.
You goddamn it, when we force you to fast, you know what you Muslims supposed to fast through there?
Anyway, man, let me make my point. The point, you had Chaplain Sabri on this show, in this studio. Chaplain Sabri, see, I used, when I was at WIGO, Chaplain Sabri is the chaplain, Christian chaplain at the penitentiary on Constitution.
Okay.
And I would go and volunteer because I used to be a talk show host at WIGO, the talk of the town, back in 92, 93. I would go into the prison.
Okay.
And what I found out is that there were no Hebrews or Hebrews in the prison that were self-avowed. So I said I wanted to go in and start doing ministry. They said, wait a minute.
We ain't going to have no medical.
We are not going to have any Hebrew Israelites come. I said, that may be the number one reason you want a Hebrew Israelite in here, because you ain't got none in here.
We don't.
There's a reason for that.
Don't make me gabble. You don't want no goddamn Hebrews up in here.
The point is.
I'm going to tell you what it is. It's the Endless War Act in the goddamn prison system.
Exactly.
And I'm all goddamn for it.
The point is, see, and what you know, what Earthworm is talking is reason.
Mm-hmm. It's absolutely.
It's understanding human, yeah. That we are human,
right,
and that our lives do matter. Mm-hmm. Once again, that mantra that the young people have is valid in this particular discussion.
But like Yanga said, we're going to have to define human rights. That's what we're like I said, I'm already with the food thing. Off the bat. But yeah. You know what I'm saying? Some of the other stuff, they can kind of debate back and forth. But when it comes to food, we need an independent person up in there saying they're not getting the calorie count.
And our fight is one and the same. It's like you said, you know, we have to define human rights for them. I always advocate, me being a black nationalist, I always say that we have to take us as Africans here in America, have to take our struggle from civil rights to human rights. Human rights violations as the same that human rights are being violated, the same way that this country so hypocritically goes and tries to police the world on human rights violations and practices the same things on their people here by through racism disguised as classism and things of
bigotry.
This nature.
That's
and bigotry and the hatred and just the blatant discrimination of a people based on their ethnicity.
Right.
Black, brown, we see what they did to the so-called red, to our Native American brothers and sisters, so it's apparent. Genocide is apparent.
That's right.
One of the things, though, before we run out of time, because we've had a pretty good discussion, what can we do? How can we aid and assist in the brothers' endeavors? Keep up the fights, too, brother.
Yeah.
Keep up the good fight.
No doubt.
But what can we do to aid and assist our comrades behind bars and bring attention and awareness to this cause?
Other than this show.
Yeah.
I think we need to definitely continue to bring awareness, but keep the pressure up. And bringing awareness is part of keeping the pressure up.
But where do we apply the pressure?
The warden and asking what's going on.
Okay.
Contacting
a number,
the
anything?
DOJ. I don't, but we can easily Google that.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
The Kelvin writes that he wants the investigator from the Department of Justice to come. And he also asked that people contact their representatives, which, like you, I share my doubts about whether the representative is actually going to represent anybody other than their
the money
pockets.
Right.
But
you sound like one of those revolutionaries there.
She is a revolutionary.
Well, and then there are different things that we need to take steps, because yes, I am a revolutionary. I believe that we need to entirely get rid of this whole system. I don't even want to be talking about what can we do to make the prisons nicer? We need to get rid of prisons altogether. But at the same time, the fact is, we in this society that we live in, we have people who are being tortured and are suffering in these prisons. And is there, you know, like you say, people matter. Black lives matter, and those black lives are being destroyed and tormented in these prisons. So, while we have this horrible system, what can we do to make those lives a little bit easier?
Well, see, the reality is, politicians and politics, other than money, what they subdue themselves to are numbers.
Yeah,
the vast numbers belong to the gender that you belong to, women. Women have to empower. See. Politicians listen to women, but women have been duped into believing that the prison industrial complex is protecting them and that they're keeping these killers that they raised in their houses away from them. If women began to organize and speak against and began to rally about this type of mistreatment, like they did in the women's suffrage movement, like they did about Vietnam, then like you as a leader, they would actually begin to listen. But as long as women think and feel that what's happening is okay and, you know, we're going along to get along, just like what they're doing to our children in the schools, then they're not going to do anything but continue to do what? Michael Jordan and all them boys that's making the big money. Now they're privatizing the prisons. It's more money to be made, and they're going to keep building.
You're
prison.
Sending mixed messages. On one hand, you're saying the women need to do this and vote this, but
no, I didn't say anything about vote now.
Hold on, didn't he just say that the women are the
did I say vote?
You said the politicians. Did he not say politicians?
Makes the majority.
Exactly.
Okay.
The majority needs to organize. See, it's the difference between organizing, like a Al Sharpton, who has his Action Network. But his focus is to tell us to vote for the killers and the liars and the thieves.
Politicians are going to hear them is when they vote. And yes,
no.
Women, hold on. Women do make up the majority of the voting populace. But we as men have to participate in that too. We don't just say, hey, y'all women need to just vote. But I don't believe in voting now. We're going to let the most. No, we got to goddamn participate.
But I think the politicians heard the voices of the people in Ferguson.
Exactly.
So okay. They voted a different way.
Thank right? you. Thank okay. you.
I think that's made what a lot I'm talking more of a about. Difference than if they'd have gone that's... to the ballot box or if they'd have had a peaceful candlelight vigil or something. That I think Ferguson has made more of a difference in police brutality than anything since the LA riots.
I wish I could tell because since Ferguson, how many deaths have we had?
They've increased.
Right.
They're still killing.
Because one of the things is. They will allow you to protest. They will allow you to rant and rave. They allow you to have a hissy fit, lay down in the street, hands up, can't shoot, I can't breathe, all the good stuff. But at the end of the day,
symbolism.
When it's right, because it's all emotionalism. Exactly. It's not back. It's reactionary and not proactive. It's not revolutionary.
Exactly.
One of the things that I think we have to look at is what to quote Sekou Toure. He said that reform can serve the revolution to a degree. Ooh. We're not reformists.
Right.
So we don't believe in that we will find our solution and our salvation in reforming the system. But I think that the hypocrisy has to be pointed out to the system. I think that you use that as an opportunity to educate the masses, to educate the dispossessed. And in this case, a lot of times it is, the African here in America.
Right.
Yes. will, in my opinion, be a part of the vanguard movement because we're one of the most dispossessed, along with the brown brothers, a lot of Latino brothers and sisters.
Absolutely.
So we have to be educated to the hypocrisy. If we're not educated to the hypocrisy, you still have people holding out and believing in an American dream because they don't know.
Exactly.
They don't really see what's going on. I say all of that to say, too, that it goes into a whole, we have to have a whole revolutionary cultural shift. The prison industrial complex being a part of the African culture here in America now that they are criminalizing us. They're looking to put, like you said, the school to prison pipeline.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
So they already got, they're privatizing.
It's already set.
Like any business, you're looking for customers.
Yes.
So they're already, getting their customer base. I think one of the things that has to happen is we have to have a revolutionary culture. And the revolutionary culture is going to include accountable spending. One of the things, and I'll be brief, that I was watching in that program I was telling you about, the Fed Up. One of the things that why these big food industries get over are lobbyists.
Yes.
Why the illegal state of Israel keeps getting over are lobbyists.
Yes.
These Zionists get over by these lobbyists.
Wait a minute.
But the
Israel is not illegal.
Yes, the illegal as hell.
Apostate.
Netanyahu is on corrupt. A mission. Netanyahu is on one.
You're right.
But so they have these lobbyists. So capitalists understand money. One of the things that we have to look at, they understand that money.
Yes.
The thing about Dr. King. When Dr. King did the Montgomery bus boycott, you think they just had a change of heart or we're going to let the Negro right on front of the bus? No, they said Negroes are withholding their nigger pennies.
Yeah, that's right.
And those pennies are adding up. You know what I'm saying?
And we're going to have to take him out.
But instead of us taking that and say, okay, let's start our own bus line, let's start our own taxi services, let's start, when they came back and said, kumbaya, to me, my beloved black brother, we rushed back in and offered economic support. So what we have to do, I think, is we have to have accountable spending.
Yes.
We have to look at people who support the prison industrial complex and say, you know what? We're going to withhold our dollars.
Yes.
We have to go for our people that do believe in reform and do believe voting. You have to write these politicians. You have to go to these things like that. You have to call these wards, the mothers who have babies, which are predominantly in the African-American
community. Hello.
Who have these babies and these husbands. And now we see an increase in women being incarcerated.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Start to form these groups.
That's right.
Start to sending out letters in them because all power lies in the people. When the people are organized.
Right.
When the people are organized, you can't stop organized people.
That's right.
And I think that that's what's going to happen. And I think that in my conclusion, this is how, like Sekou Toure said, reform will serve the revolution. That when we come together and we organize and we start putting the pressure on and we make them blatantly be hypocrites.
Yes,
you have to make them blatantly be hypocrites. And when they're blatant hypocrites, it's like Dr. King said, one of the reasons they had to give, John F. K. and all of them, and then Lyndon B. Johnson had to sign the Civil Rights Bill, is because he made them blatant hypocrites.
Yeah, because they were going to take it back 50 years later.
Right, and when he made them blatant hypocrites on camera, then the world was seeing, and they were saying, hold on, that's not a civil rights issue anymore. That's a human rights violation.
That's right. Yeah.
So you have to say, we have to make them blatant hypocrites, showing the world that we can't get any justice from the same people that are oppressing us. So we need... the human rights, the world, the International Criminal Court, the ICC that the Palestinians are a part of, has to step in. We're not even talking about the UN.
That America owns? Yeah, right.
Well, America owns the UN.
Now. Hello.
But they got this division, this ICC division. But just bring it up there. And the only reason you do that is so that when revolution does come, that the people can't criminalize you. You know what I'm saying? That the world already knows why the revolution is in effect.
Right.
When Egypt went in the revolution, you know, they did so much good propaganda that the people said, oh, yeah, Egypt should have voted there in the revolution. But if you don't do your propaganda, if the world doesn't know your plight, if the world doesn't know what you're fighting for, the only thing this country is going to do is say, look at these bunch of rowdy Negro criminals.
Like Palestine.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Well, let's let Earthworm have her last, synopsis and everything. How much time are we looking at?
About 5 minutes, yeah.
So another thing that you asked, what can we do? I think another really crucial thing is write these guys yourself. And show them that they're not forgotten about, they're not, you know, isolated, they're not, we talked about having this concept of a criminal element that's just somebody, an underclass that doesn't deserve the same rights as everybody else.
Right.
And that mentality can really be internalized and can lead to that idea of hopelessness.
Mm-hmm.
So reach out to these guys, because they really are just like you or me. Mm-hmm.
They are you and me.
Exactly. So, and they have their writings on atlanta.indymedia.org. And that website, it may be down right now, but keep trying. Go back to atlanta.indymedia.org.
You said that super fast. You got some older people that may want to say that. Atlanta what?
Atlanta, period, indie media, with a Y, I-N-D-Y, media.org.
Okay.
And just scroll down that front page and you'll see different writings, different articles, and different recordings that these guys have made, so you can look in their own words. And at the bottom of those articles, they've put their addresses, and they'd be eager and happy to hear from you, just to let them know that you support them or you heard them or whatever the case may be. And that way you can start that conversation and you can find out what's going on, and you can learn from them how they'd best need you to help.
Well, you know, it's in conclusion, I just this is a very valid conversation, and I just appreciate your wisdom and your concern. I used to get a lot of letters when I was a talk show host at WIGO from prisoners,
right?
And they're reaching out. They are us. We are them. Because in reality, we all, I said it in jest, but in reality, we are in a cell block called America, and it is on death row.
And wait a minute, you don't like this good country of ours here?
Well,
you need to go back after that. Go back where Israel, I don't know where it is you came from.
Well, when Marcus Messiah Garvey tried to help us to go back, they criminalized, like, man, what you doing taking away? Y'all ain't going nowhere. Matter of fact, we're going to deport you after we almost make you sick and try to kill you. And that's basically what she's saying. They're trying to kill our people. They're trying to kill us by the foods that we eat, by incarceration, by hopelessness and helplessness, and we need to support one another.
Absolutely. Where's, you know, a surplus? You know, it came over here. It's like I said, we got to look at the prisons, a big business. We have to, a lot of times, we have to tackle it. We tackle it from the, you know, the humanitarian aspect of it. Also, you know, just find out, I would advise my people, man, accountable spending, find out companies that have a stock in
That's
prisons.
Right,
find
yes.
out who's investing in these prisons and withhold your funds. Withhold your funds. We have to start being accountable. We have to start doing the research.
Mm.
You know, and once we start doing that, then we become a force. Mm. So we attack it on the humanitarian aspect, attack it on the economical aspect, attack it on every aspect that it can be attacked from.
Well, you know, and the scripture says that the Most High, I know, but some people don't believe in that, going to have to come and open up the prisoners. You know what I'm talking about? Because other than that, they ain't going to let nobody, they're not going to let our people go. Just like they didn't let us go under Marcus Messiah Garvey, they're not going to let us go now, because they are killers, liars, thieves, and America is a penal colony.
Gideon, that's the problem. You're waiting for them to let you go. But that's, you know, that's
I'm already free
show.
Here and here, Howard.
Not reading that dang Bible. All right.
We do it like
okay,
that.
Okay, next week, we're going to deal with Yemen. We got Ahmed. Hey, we're going to have you on here next week. So
we got Ali right out there in the control room.
No, don't you? Yemen.
Okay, all right. Yemen. There you go. That's Ali, baby. Yemen. Yeah, I'm the lie.
He's from Somalia, not Yemen.
Okay, July this way. You know
see,
the
name. See how the niggas do.
Yemen.
blessing to the people in the control room.
Yeah,
for making it do what it do, baby. You know what I mean? Switch. Real talk. Hey, yeah, Vince, you out there somewhere. You know what I'm talking about? We love you, baby. Come back. Say,
Come back. You know what I'm talking about? Get that butt whipping.
But we definitely want to thank Irv. We definitely want to thank Irv.
Definitely want to thank the beautiful, powerful spirit. That earthworm is
And bringing this issue, because this is a serious issue. So on, you know, on the conclusion, real talk, fam, get involved. Find out what's going on. Check out atlanta.indymedia.org. Check that out. Check out some of the writing. Start writing. Find out what you can do. I would advocate getting support groups for you brothers and sisters, for all of us who have. I have a nephew behind enemy lines.
Don't forget the Arena Uncensored.
Right, the Arena Uncensored. Check us out. You can check us out on YouTube, all one word, the Arena Uncensored. Get involved, man.
Yeah. And when you type in, tell them when you type in YouTube, you have to hit it.
Go on, tell them.
Yeah. Okay, basically, when you type in the Arena Uncensored, run it all together, when you hit enter, YouTube gonna separate it again, and he gonna say, "What do you mean all together?" And that's when you click. That's us right there.
They don't want you being.
And of course, you
big shouts out, dude. Let's send a big shout out to Cop Watch.
No doubt. And of course, you're gonna see the Hero Y'all program on the Arena Uncensored as well. Yeah, I'm talking about. So peace to all the fam out there. Yeah, you know I mean. Praise Yah and his anointed son, Yahshua. Bleed that. He's grown.
Oh, you got it.
Well, we still Lord, I guess.
Yeah, praise. All praises. Yeah. Any other words you want to say, Earthworm?
Well, the word genocide is a heavy word, and I wouldn't use it just frivolously, but I really do think that the prison system and the system of mass incarceration that we have is a genocide against Black people in the U.S.
Yeah. Police, food,
The police kill you. They're isolating all the men away from the population. Yes. They're just driving the population down.
Yes.
So it's something that we really, all in this country, would serve us all to unite and fight together.
Absolutely.
Well, because when they dehumanize us, then they no longer value our lives anyway.
So let me send a shout out to AIM too, man. Big shout out to AIM, the American Indian Movement, doing it, fighting against these sports teams that are. Even Cleveland, we got Chief Yahoo McDaniel on the hat, the Cleveland Indians, these Redskins, and all this, who defame and have derogatory images of our Native Americans. So big shout out to AIM. They're like. Sister Earthworm is saying, man, that if you're a human being,
yes,
if you're a human being, then it would be advantageous for the world.
Yes.